why would we not take into account in that balancing test you'd have us do the identity of the victim as going to tribal sovereignty, given the history in this country of states abusing Indian victims in their courts? George Washington wrote letters about this at the outset of the nation's history. In the 1920s, Oklahoma systematically used its state courts to deprive Indians of their property when oil was discovered on their lands. There's a long history of this. Congress has provided as well a mechanism for tribes who wish to opt in to state concurrent jurisdiction in Public Law 280. So that's available. We know that. They've chosen not to. Should that be something we consider? And then finally, two more things. We have the treaties, okay, which have been in existence and promising this tribe since before the Trail of Tears that they would not be subject to state jurisdiction precisely because the states were known to be their enemies. Does that count in your balancing, your new Bracker balancing test, which we've never heretofore applied in criminal law? And then finally, you say we have to worry about blood quantum when it comes to victims. Well, wouldn't that also be true when we have to deal with defendants? It's apparently not a worry there. I don't know why it would be a worry here. So there's a lot for you to chew on.
I think there were four things in your question, Justice Gorsuch.
At least.
Let me start with those four and feel free to add others. First, the tribal interest here. I think that this court consistently has defined the tribal interest as the interest in punishing tribal offenders. When engaging in balancing, the court has not defined that interest more broadly as an interest in protecting victims. That having been said, obviously we acknowledge—
The treaties are irrelevant then?
Well, I was going to—
Our history is irrelevant? Oklahoma's history is irrelevant?